this list. So I was always more active and consistently active during this time. So just the whole combination really helped me to be able to get farther and faster and do more and do longer hikes and to be able to explore the area more with a limited amount of time that you have doing a 2 or 3 day hike. So one definition I want to explain is base weight. So base weight is almost everything in your backpack. It's not going to be consumable. So you don't include food, you don't include water. Other things like fuel, if you're using a fuel canister, it varies. At the beginning of your trip, it's lighter, it's heavier than at the end of your trip when you use some. Same thing with sunscreen or bug spray. I honestly include a lot of those consumables when I'm talking about my pack weight. I include everything except for food and water, just because it's easier for me. I'm not going to say, oh, well, you know, minus an ounce because of, you know, my little bug spray packets and my toothpaste. It's not something that I do a whole lot. So when I talk about my base weight, it's everything minus food and water. But there's some people that they'll take it another level and it's minus anything that's consumable. So there's different categories of weights. And I really want to stress it's not about how much weight you have in your backpack. It's what you're comfortable with. But people like definitions, so we have kind of a breakdown. An expedition-sized backpack is going to weigh about 65 pounds or more if you're doing an extreme hike like Everest or Kilimanjaro or Mount Hood, something like that, Rainier. Then you're going to need to have an expedition-sized backpack, you're going to have winter gear, just a lot of safety items that you typically wouldn't have otherwise. So there is a time and place for a lot of gear, you know, for safety reasons, if that's the type of hike you're doing. Then you have where most people fall is traditional. So it's 35 pounds, give or take. Lightweight is going to be 10 to 25 pounds. Ultralight is 10 pounds or less. And then super ultralight, which a lot of people like to call cycolite, is 5 pounds or less. So, and this is all base weight. So this isn't including your consumables. So there's a huge variation within each category. So it might take people years to go from lightweight to ultralight, and it really depends on your trip. For example, if I'm winter hiking, then I might be more in the lightweight category versus the ultralight category. If I'm doing a day hike, then I can get down to super ultralight. It really depends on my goals for the day and what I'm carrying. But I'm really not too conscious unless I'm backpacking, because on a day hike, the weight doesn't matter as much as if you're backpacking and you need to carry something physically on your back all day, every day. So where to start? The first thing you'll want to do is you'll get a scale. So what I like to do is I get one of those little kitchen scales, and I put all the little items, so I literally weigh everything. So you have two multi-tools. This one weighs so much more than this one. And what you'll want to do is just, you know, see, do I need the features on this? Does this really help me? Does this do just fine? You know, you'll want to find one that has the features that you'll actually use, and you don't want to, you know, go out somewhere and realize that you're missing something that you absolutely need. But if you weigh both of these, you can save a lot of weight if you replace this times 5 or times 10 different items you do the same thing for, it does add up. So I use a kitchen scale for that, and then I use just a regular scale, or you can use a luggage scale to weigh your backpack with your gear, all your items. You know, you can really get a good feel on how much you're bringing and how big it is. So find out what category you fall under. So the categories I just listed with the expedition, the traditional lightweight, ultralight, or super ultralight, and you're going to want to figure out where you are and where you want to go. So if you're a traditional, going super ultralight doesn't make sense for you. Just be realistic, and like I said before, it's more of a process. So the second part is to do your homework. So start reading books, articles, look at blogs online. There's tons of them.
I blog at thrillthesummit.com. I have a resource list at the end with a ton of other websites and blogs, and there's just tons of information online if you search for it. So you'll be able to see what works for others and take that and make it into what works for you. One person's ideas and thoughts and strategies might not work for you. So when I say kind of, you know, take it with a grain of salt, it works for me. It's been a transition and a process, and I'll go through some of that with you, but it might not work for you. So don't automatically think that, you know, you have to go out and get the gear that I use. Now, the last part is to try it out. So you'll go on a hike, and then when you get back, you're going to make piles. So you'll have a pile for gear you used all the time, gear that you barely used, and gear that you didn't touch. Now, those piles are going to be important, and I'll explain in just a minute what those are for. So what you'll do is you'll take all of your gear. You can make a spreadsheet by hand. You can go on a website like letterpack.com, and you can categorize all your gear. So this website's really neat because it has colors for categories. You can see, you know, your shelter, how much it weighs compared to your sleep system, and kind of get an idea of where you're at, and, you know, you can compare it to friends and see the differences and what you can change and, you know, what you can work on. So that's really nice. With your piles, you want to make sure that, you know, something like your first aid kit, you have your first aid and you barely use it, that's great because you're not getting injured on the trail, or your friends are and you just don't care and you never open up your kit for them. But you want to make sure, obviously, you bring something like that. Rain gear. You want to bring that, you know, if there's any chance in New England, it always rains sometime when you're backpacking, it's going to happen. So there might be items that you don't use on that particular hike that you still need. And you might be able to say, well, I have this really heavy, bulky rain jacket, and I don't think I need one like this. I'm going to change it out. So those piles are important, but don't automatically get rid of something because you didn't use it then. So some of your considerations for a backpack. These are the two backpacks I tend to use the most. This one I use for day hiking. They're both made by Gosmer Gear. I like their gear a lot. Like I said earlier, what I like might not be exactly what you're looking for in gear, but this is what works really well for me. So this is my day hiking pack. For those that were here earlier, I'm working on the 100 highest list, and it involves a lot of bushwhacking, a lot of off-trail hiking. So the mesh on these, you know, they've been beaten up. So there's a lot of holes, and like I have a giant hole in this pocket, just from trees and stuff like that. It works fine for that. You know, do I wish it were a little bit different? Just a little, just for that. But overall, this is a really multi-purpose backpack that I use for all sorts of day hikes, and I can actually do an overnight in this backpack. So that's nice. Then if I'm doing a longer hike, if I'm doing, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6, you know, plus days, I use this backpack. This is the Gorilla. This one's called the Type 2. So this one is a larger capacity. There's another backpack called the Mariposa, and I use that if I need to carry a bear canister, like out if I go out west. But this one for New England is perfect. It has enough capacity for everything I need. But when you're looking at backpacks, that's kind of your last item that you'll purchase because you don't know how big all your gear is. So this is one of my sleeping bags. You might find that you have 6 of everything eventually. So this stuffs down pretty small. And what I actually do is I pack all of my gear and then I stuff this into my backpack without a stuff sack. So instead of it being a solid block, I'm filling in all the gaps because even with a backpack that's not that big, this actually folds down, you know, and puffs out obviously, but I have extra room, so I use this to fill the gaps. So you'll want to get your backpack last because you don't know the capacity unless you know your gear. So once you have all your gear, and like I said, you're going to be transitioning. So you might have a backpack that's a little small, and you might have to stick with your older backpack, and then slowly transition to that, or just find unique ways to kind of attach your equipment if, you know, you don't have as much spacing as you would like until your gear starts to get a little lighter and a little smaller, which can take years to do. So, conditions. If I'm winter hiking, I don't use this backpack. It's big enough. It has great capacity. I'm able to fit, you know, a sleeping bag. I use this for backpacking. But in the winter, the problematic part is it has this mesh pocket. And in the winter, the trees, the snow falls, and I end up carrying a pound or more of snow in my backpack. So that's just one thing that you're not going to get one backpack that works for day hiking and backpacking in winter and every little thing that you do. So you want to find something that fits most of your needs, but you'll need to invest in something else if you have mobile passions, if you're not just a day hiker or just a backpacker. You can't have one thing that does everything very well. So your style of hiking, like I mentioned, if you're doing day hikes versus bushwhacking versus, you know, high mileage versus, you know, you like to camp a lot, so you carry more items that you use for leisure at camp. It really depends on your goals, what you're going to bring, and what you're going to carry in. So I like to use three different methods when I'm planning my hike and picking out my gear. The first, or it goes cheapest to most expensive. That's how I like to do things. I like to spend a lot of money on gear. So the first is to rethink something. For example, I used to wear hiking boots. When I started my 4,000 footers, I wore boots and I got blisters and I didn't know why. I thought you just did. And I kind of figured out what works for me, and trail runners work really well for me. And then I had to go through a whole nother process of finding the right trail runners. I have really big feet, and they've grown since hiking, and my toes need a lot of space. When I hike the John Muir Trail, it's 220 miles, and about halfway through, I was sewing up where my pinky toes are because I didn't have enough room. So I found out the hard way that I needed more toe space, so I went with another shoe, and that still wasn't enough, so I found these are ultra Lone Peaks, and they happen to work very well for me. And these are the waterproof ones, which I'm kind of still figuring out if I like them for fall and winter, early spring kind of stuff. I have the non-waterproof one, and it's covered in mud, and it's disgusting, and it would smell this entire room, so I didn't bring them. But they're the exact same thing, but with a different, it doesn't have the neoshell material on my other ones. So with these, I wear them at camp. I don't change to camp shoes. So if you're used to wearing boots and your feet are dying to get out of them when you get to camp, then you bring trail shoes. You know, that's one thing you can eliminate if trail running happens to work for you. Other things, you know, you might think, oh yeah, I'm going to bring multiple books, and I'm going to bring a pack of playing cards for me and my friends to play at camp. And then you hike all day, you eat dinner, you clean up from dinner, you're exhausted, you go to bed. Do you really need the playing cards? Do you need, you know, all these extra items? So it's just something to really think about what your goals are, what you're going to be spending most of your time doing, so you can rethink a lot of the gear that you'll be bringing. My second favorite thing to do is to repackage things. Now, if you're going from an expedition-size backpack or the top of the tier of, you know, traditional weight backpack, you're at 35, 40, 50 pounds. Replacing, you know, repackaging your sunscreen isn't going to help too much. So you want to rethink and just eliminate items that you take with you. Then the second thing you'll do is repackage. So, for example, instead of a whole tube of sunscreen, I have just a little bottle. And this, there's a website called Minimus, and you can order this, these kind of packages, REI, EMS, they sell some. The selection isn't the best. But you can also, Amazon has some little bottles like this. And I just repackage it. When you're backpacking, especially when you have a chance to resupply, it's really important. So instead of carrying a whole thing of sunscreen, you have a small version of this. You you can carry travel-size versions of items. These even come in wipes. So, you know, if you just need a couple of these because you don't know if it's going to be buggy at all, but it's not spring, so you know it's not going to be crazy buggy, this is great just to have with you. They're so small. When I'm day hiking, I just carry this all the time in my kit. So you just want to make sure that you are minimizing the amount of space that you're taking up in your backpack and weight that you have. But like I said, you know, one thing you can do is you can use a dehydrator and you can make toothpaste solid tabs. So you just put droplets that would be big enough to use for brushing your teeth and you dehydrate them. I know it sounds crazy. You dehydrate them and then you actually chew them and it foams up and that's how you brush your teeth. That saves a lot of weight versus using a whole tube. But if you're carrying a ton of weight because your sleeping bag is synthetic and it weighs, you know, 5 pounds, then don't bother doing this. It's just, you have to figure out the progression for you. The last thing is the most expensive thing to do is to replace your gear. I'm going to go through the big three, and those are the three categories that you want to focus on the most with replacing your gear. Alright, so your big three, it's your shelter, your sleep system, and your pack. Your shelter is going to consist of your tent, your tarp, whatever it is that you use to sleep. Your sleep system is going to be your sleeping bag, your pad, you can bring a pillow, whatever it is that you bring to keep yourself warm and comfortable in your tent. And then your last part is your pack. And depending on what you use, you're going to have different parts of your sleep system in your shelter. Cat not included. So the first one is, make sure this is, yeah, that's right. The first one is going to be your backpack. So a lot of people just always think, oh, well, ultralight backpacking is so expensive and I can't afford it and there's no way I can transition and it's only for, you know, elite people that, I don't know, have all this money laying around. I do not. You know, as I said multiple times, it's something you transition to, so, you know, you might ask for your birthday to get a new backpack. That's your big item you want for your birthday. Or, you know, you save $10 every week from your paycheck and, you know, instead of going out to dinner all the time, you know, you focus on getting gear so you can go on adventures with your friends or your family. So it's just kind of prioritizing your money and your time. And it's also just buying smart. So this backpack is the one I used on the John Muir Trail, and it's the biggest one out of all of Gosfreger's backpacks, and it's also the most expensive one. So Osprey is a huge brand. You can find them everywhere. A lot of people use them. You know, perfectly fine backpack. Works great for a lot of people. $259 for the backpack, 4 pounds, 11 ounces. If you go on REI, and I think EMS does this too, it's categorized as lightweight. I don't think almost 5 pounds is lightweight. So the big three, your goal, if you want to go lightweight, is to have each of those categories be 3 pounds or less. So if your backpack is almost 5 pounds, then you can't bring a sleeping bag, because that's going to bring you way over. It's just one of those things that it's marketing, and it's, you know, it's big companies trying to call themselves lightweight when they're really not. So it's frustrating because you can't go into the store and get a lot of these smaller, you know, there's a lot of smaller companies that have great gear and they're not available in stores. So you go in and you're able to try it on and the person at the store tells you, oh, this is really lightweight and it's great and it's our best seller. And you say, oh, if everyone's using it, then it should work great for me. So that's just one of the things is, you know, when you're shopping, you don't always need to get what everyone else is using or, you know, something that is just advertised as one thing. Just try out different options and see what works for you. So this just shows that it doesn't have to be more expensive to go lighter. As you see, the Mariposa is slightly less expensive than, you know, the Osprey, and it's, you know, 60 ounces about, 60 liters for, you know, very similar pricing and very similar capacity. Yes?
How do you try them out without wasting the money to buy them and then realize it's not going to
So a lot of companies, their policy is, you know, you can try it on and all that, but you just can't go on trail with it and, you know, dirty it, take the tags off. So what I've done, particularly with shoes, is I'll buy 3 pairs of shoes, try them on. If they're not going to fit, like, try them on with the socks you're going to wear around the house. You can even put items into a backpack in a store, stuff like that, and then decide, you know, if this is going to work for me or not. There is the risk that you're going to run that, you know, it feels really good right now, and then you get on the trail and it's gone. The other thing you can do is, you know, personally, just borrow from friends, or some outing clubs have gear that you can borrow. You can also rent gear at places like REI and all that. So that's another option is, you know, if you aren't used to backpacking, if you don't do it, want to get into it, you don't know if it's worth the money to invest in something, then you can rent it. A lot of companies have really good return policies too. So look into that before you do purchase the gear, so you're not wasting your money if you just never use it again and, you know, decide in a week that it's just not right for you. So the other category is your sleep system. So that's going to be consisting of your sleeping pad, your sleeping bag, your quilt. I have an Enlighten Equipment quilt, which is very similar to the Z-Packs. It doesn't have a back to it, it just has a clip. So you don't have a zipper. So you're saving all the zipper weight by not having one. And the whole purpose is not just to take out fabric and make it cold. Mine's actually rated 20 degrees. And what happens is, you know, this is a traditional sleeping bag. I just have it open. So when it's closed and you're sleeping on this, you're compressing all of the material behind you with your weight. So you're essentially not using any of the insulation, because the insulation only works when it's puffy. So a quilt just eliminates the material, so you're not crushing it. There's nothing to crush. So it actually has straps that you put around your sleeping pad, and that way it doesn't move around, and you're saving weight that way. So I have a 20 degree quilt that's really great. This is a 32 degree sleeping bag. One of the ways you can save some weight without going out and buying a new sleeping bag if you don't have one that's warm enough is you just get a silk liner. And like, I got this one at EMS, I think. It's a Sea to Summit silk liner, and it's supposed to add about 10 degrees to your sleeping bag. I'm not a particularly cold sleeper. You know, I'm not a very warm sleeper, but I'm pretty average. So this actually worked really well for me. When I was on the John Muir Trail, I didn't want to go and invest in a whole new sleeping bag. But afterwards I did. I think it was, they had some flash sale, or it was right before the holidays. So 4th of July, Memorial Day, and then Black Friday, even small manufacturers, they have really good sales. So one of the things you want to do is kind of wait for the best time to buy something, instead of being impulsive and just buying it because you need it. So your sleep system, you have your sleeping bag or your quilt, and it's going to depend on, you know, the style, and the quilts don't have hoods, a sleeping bag does, so this one is going to insulate you over your head. Quilt, if you're going to be bringing a winter hat anyway for cold nights, then you use that. So you'll want to make sure that your sleeping bag or your quilt or whatever you're using is warm enough that you don't want to freak yourself out and say, well, the average temperature is going to be 30 degrees, so I need to bring a 20 degree sleeping bag. You don't need to go crazy with it. Kind of try it out in your backyard in temperatures that are similar. But what you can also do is use your own clothing as part of your sleep system. So I've slept plenty of time in long underwear and, you know, my short sleeve shirt and my long sleeve shirt, my puffy jacket with the hood up and my hat, and I can be in much colder temperatures because I'm wearing all of this gear. So I bring, one of the things I like to bring, being lightweight, it's not about not having anything, not enjoying yourself. So I do bring a couple items. Like I bring a nice camera to take pictures because that's important. I like to take pictures while I'm on the trail. And I also bring warm sleep socks, like smart wool socks,
And I wear, they're called Ginji toe socks, and they're really thin wool socks, and it's all the toes, so I don't get blisters that way. And then I have special socks that I wear for sleeping. So you can indulge, and you can get things that are nice for you. It doesn't have to be all or nothing. But, you know, when you add your own clothing to your sleep system, and you do it purposefully, then you don't have to have the lowest rating sleeping bag. Because obviously the lower the rating is, the more insulation there is, and the heavier it is. The type of sleep system you're going to have is really dependent on where you're going to hike. So if you have, you know, there's synthetic or there's, you know, natural fiber sleeping bags. If you're using a down, like a natural down sleeping bag, if it gets wet, it takes forever to dry out. So if you're hiking somewhere that there's torrential rains all the time, or in the winter, you might want a synthetic bag. But typically, wool, you're keeping it, not wool, down, you're keeping it in your backpack, and it's not getting wet because you're just careful with your gear. You're not going to just leave it out all night and, I don't know, run around in the rain with it on. So I like to carry down as often as I can. It does weigh a lot less than synthetic. Your sleeping pad. There's a lot of different options. This is the craziest option that you can get. If you're not, there's foam sleeping pads, there's inflatable, there's self-inflating. There's all different varieties. So with me, I can kind of sleep wherever. I'm one of those that every time I get on a plane, I sleep on the plane. If I'm on a train or a bus, I sleep wherever. So this blows up in, I don't know, 5 or 6 breaths. It's really quick. And there's holes, and it's the same kind of theory as the quilt. I don't pair the two together, actually. I've never done that. But this is a 3/4 length, so when you're sleeping on it, your legs aren't actually on it. So what I do is I use my backpack with anything left over in it. If you're out here, you'll want to hang your food in a bear bag. Out west, use a bear canister. So your food's separate, but everything else is in your backpack that you're not using. So not a whole lot of stuff, but it's a little something. So you actually put your backpack at the foot of where you're sleeping and use that to prop your feet up. So, yeah, it's one of those things that's not like sleeping in your own bed. So this is, I believe this is only 6 or 8 ounces, so it's really lightweight. It packs up, obviously, very small. And my favorite thing to do, I have a slide on this later, but I will show you now, is I will actually use this back pocket. All the Gossamy Gear backpacks come with a sit pad, and there's some other brands that do too. I will actually fold this up and, you know, have it so it's actually the size of this, and I'll blow it up slightly so I'll have a little padding. Especially if you have a bear canister or something that's rigid, then it gives you a little padding. So it's just a nice little feature to have that you can't usually use with a large sleeping pad that's, you know, more luxurious. So I kind of pamper myself while I'm hiking during the day if I'm going to be using that at night. So that's your sleep system. Like I said, there's foam sleeping pads. There's, you know, if you're going to be in an area that's extra rocky and a lot of roots and things that you don't know if you'll pop your inflatable pad. You can bring extra patches and stuff as well, but you can use that. There's a few different ones that I've tried. There's a New Sea to Summit one that's pretty good. They have a whole line of them, and that's probably the most comfortable. It's a little heavier. It's a lot heavier than something like this, but it's, you know, it's an average weight, and if it's something that you want to have a really good night's sleep, and that's important to you, then splurge a little and get something that's a little heavier and just kind of be more aware of the other things that you bring. Alright, so this is where it gets expensive. So there's some items like backpacks and sleep systems. You know, you can get away with getting items that aren't crazy expensive. Your sleeping bag, unfortunately, there's just no way, you know, get a good sale, go on eBay, try to get a used sleeping bag. I got that. It's a Western Mountaineering bag. So this is the one I have. It retails for $379. I didn't spend that much money on that one. I did spend, I think, almost $300 on it, so it's an investment. I'll use it forever if I take care of it, but it's not cheap. So I'm not going to tell you that everything's going to be the same price or cheaper than heavier items. It's just not realistic. If you get, you know, the Marmot Sunset 30, that's a averagely popular synthetic bag. It's $179, so it's a pretty inexpensive sleeping bag for what it is. But it's 2 pounds, 13 ounces, so, you know, a pound is 16 ounces, so it's really almost 3 pounds. The Western Mountaineering is just over a pound. The Enlightened Equipment one is 1 pound. If you add some extra insulation or bring the temperature rating down for any of these bags, obviously they'll weigh a little bit more. But if you're looking for a good summer sleeping bag, something you can use late spring to maybe early fall, 30-32 degree bag is perfect. If you want to go winter camping, you need a whole new set of gear. So, you know, your sleeping bag is unfortunately the item that you'll have to really invest in if you want a lighter sleeping bag. So this is just kind of an overview of different sleeping pad options. This is the bottom right is the Ridgecrest, and that's a foam pad, and you can actually modify it by cutting it smaller, and you can use a piece of it for a sit pad for day hiking, and you can use the rest of it for sleeping. It's very, very minimal. So it really just depends on your goals. This is an inflatable sleeping pad that there's all different sizes, so you can kind of decide what length you want for you. And shelters. So this is where there's a huge variety in the types of shelters that you can have. So on your top left, you have your tarp. So tarps are really, they can be incredibly great. It's just going to take more skill. So people tend to have, you know, freestanding tents where you can, or non-freestanding tents, there's two different varieties. So the non-freestanding is you have to stake it in, freestanding you don't. So if you get the non-freestanding, you have to stake it in, and you have, you know, the stakes obviously, which can add some weight, you can get titanium stakes. But those, you can have a variety that makes it weigh more or less, just depending on the type. So with the tarp, you have a lot of great airflow, it's compact, you know, they're incredibly small, but obviously there's no protection from bugs, so if you're in an incredibly buggy area, then it might not work for you. Also, you have to be very conscious of where you set up the tarp and the direction you set it up in. So if you know there's a storm coming, I know people that they use tarps all the time, they swear by them, they never get wet in a rainstorm, they're just, you know, they practice so much that they know exactly how to set it up. And, you know, the thing is, you might set it up and then a storm changes directions and you have to get up and actually change the setup of your tarp. So there's some trade-offs. The other is if you get a cubic fiber tarp, which is the more expensive and lighter version, it's just going to cost you more money. So the tent is where I go. This is a tarp style tent. I actually have it with me. So it's a pound. This is the whole thing. It's very small. It's probably a little longer than an Nalgene. But I don't have any poles. There's no poles to set this up. You actually use your trekking pole. So as you're hiking throughout the day, you're using your trekking pole, and then at night you're using it to hold your shelter up. So it's just multi-purpose. You're not carrying extra poles, extra gear, and pack's really small. So it's a really great option. So the one that I have right here, it's Six Moon Designs, it's the Wild Oasis. I think they have a newer version since I bought this one. It doesn't have a floor, so that's a little different than more traditional style tents. There's some that they have, it's called a bathtub floor. This one has some bug netting, so it uses gravity, it keeps the bugs out, and then you can use Tyvek, but even lighter, which is what I use, is a piece of polychrome. You can get it, the different manufacturers sell it. I believe you can get it on Amazon, but it's also just the window cling that construction workers use on windows. So it's literally a piece of plastic that you're sleeping on. So it's, I call it, you know, the sandwich bag sleeping system. So you can just lay it down on the ground and it keeps, you know, bugs and moisture and all that stuff. It keeps you clean and dry. And I actually use it instead of a pack cover, I'm using it to line the inside of my backpack. So anything that's in my external pockets, it's okay for me to get wet, you know, like food items that, you know, they're packaged and it's fine. But everything I want to keep dry, I have inside my backpack, and then I line it with the plastic, and it stays extremely dry. So, just another multi-useful item, and it weighs, I don't know, an ounce. So I like using that. So, with a tent, it really depends, you know, the non-freestanding tents, you're going to have to practice where you can stake it down and setting it up right. This one has two different options, so you can set it up a little higher so you have nice airflow, and then you can also set it up in storm mode, which I always found a little finicky. So you just have to practice more at home and do some trial runs before you go on a long trip. The bottom slide, this one is a bivy, and I don't really recommend bivies for anyone, unless you want to feel like you're in a coffin. It's just, I don't know, it doesn't really have any benefits for me. It can be very lightweight, but you have no privacy that you would have with a tarp or a tent, you know, if you are getting changed, or I couldn't see myself reading a book laying down in a bivy. So, for me, it's just not the best option. You do have, you know, no poles. You have the bug netting to protect yourself, so it does have the features that you would need, but for me, it's just not worth being uncomfortable and feeling claustrophobic. So yeah, it's very confined, and then your weight for a tarp can be less than that. It can weigh a little less than a tent, so it just depends on your options, but weight-wise, it's kind of, you know, it could be a good option if that's something you like. And then your last option, there's a lot of people that got super into hammocking that I know. And I tried the hammock thing. I got one, that's mine. That's actually in Baxter State Park. And the only spot to hang a hammock if you're car camping with friends is like on the edge of a cliff. So just one of the things, if you're camping in the woods, you can find whatever spot you want in New England. It's really great because there's so many trees. But if you're in a campsite or you're somewhere where, you know, if you're hiking, I know someone that hiked the Arizona Trail and they used a hammock and they found a spot every night. But I'm sure they were very picky on where they stopped because you have to find trees that are the right length apart. So with that option, you know, you have the airflow. It's very, very comfortable. I'll give the hammock people that. It's very comfortable. You have bug netting. There's a lot of options that where you can camp where you can't camp with a normal tent because you don't need to worry about ground space. But the airflow is also a negative. I know a guy who tried using a hammock at Keo, which is if you're hiking the Bonds, and it's almost 4,000 feet up, and it's way too cold. It's just there's too much air, there's too much wind. So he was freezing, and he had to go into the shelter because he couldn't stay warm in his hammock. So they actually have an underquilt, so it's basically like an open sleeping bag that you clip underneath, and that runs a few $100s depending on what you get for one. So you have the weight of that because you have this and your sleeping bag. You don't have a sleeping pad. You could use one, but you don't need to. So it adds more weight with, you need a tarp to go over it, and you need your underquilt. So it can add a lot of weight if you're going in conditions that aren't exceptionally warm. Yes?
So for the smaller, any of the shelters that are more confining.
Yep.
When it rains, like the tent that we have, if you touch the side, you get wet.
Yes.
Same for all of these.
Yeah, so there's, you have your double layer and your single layer, and I find that the single layer doesn't collect the moisture as much, but it's one of those, you know, you can't stand up and bang the sides of them. So I think those are much better for that purpose. I've been in a huge thunderstorm where it poured the whole night and I didn't get wet at all. But, you know, you're not, that's a single person, and I had plenty of room. But it's not one of those, like, I have a six-person tent that I use for car camping that we call the Taj Mahal because it's, you can stand up, even if you're maybe 6 feet tall, you can stand up in it and you're good. So, yeah, it's not going to be something that you can kind of sprawl all your stuff out and, you know, you touch the sides of the tent and you are going to get some condensation, some moisture.
So, like a little...
Yeah, that, I haven't personally used a bivy in real action. It just, I don't see the benefit of them personally. And I don't really know many people that use a bivy. It just doesn't really have any features that kind of outweigh using something else. All right, so hydration. You don't want to get sick. One of the things, some people, I don't know what they're thinking, but they say, I'm going ultra lightweight. I'm not carrying all this stupid stuff that, you know, is going to weigh something. I'm not going to carry a filter, and I'm just going to drink from the streams because I'm in the wild, and, you know, what can go wrong? So, they don't carry a filter. I'm going to talk about filters right after this, but one of the biggest revelations that I had was just simple things like a water bottle can be a big difference in weight. So most of you probably use Nalgene's or have at least at some point or another. I use a Nalgene for the winter because it'll keep your water from freezing. You use a Nalgene and then you put it in a koozie with a zipper and it keeps your water from freezing, so it does have a purpose. But on the trail, when it's warm, it's so heavy. So you have a 1 liter Nalgene, empty, nothing in it. The bottle weighs 6.2 ounces. If you have two of them empty, which a lot of people do, they'll have one with them in, you know, their pocket, and they'll have another one in their backpack, or both side pockets of their backpack, they have one. So two empty is 12.4 ounces. And remember, a pound is 16 ounces. So, you know, you're almost at a pound just with the Nalgene. So it's just a lot of weight to carry. And obviously, you know, water weighs a lot in itself and you have to have it. So the more you can do to kind of reduce the amount of weight that your water is using in your backpack, the better. So I use two different options. The first is I'll use a bladder. I started using a Camelback bladder. And it has kind of like a circular screw closure, and I wasn't a huge fan of that because honestly I've gotten huge leaks multiple times in my kitchen or all of my gear because you have to screw it on just right. I prefer the platypus one because it just has a regular screw top. It's so much easier and it weighs a little bit less than a Camelback. So a 2 liter platypus is 1.2 ounces. And then your other option, if you want to use flavor drinks, tablets that have electrolytes or Gatorade or something like that, plastic bottle, it's almost free. I prefer smart water bottles because of the shape. It fits into the pockets in my backpack really nicely. And the screw top, you can actually screw a filter right onto that. So, you know, it's what, $1 for a bottle of water at the store. You can actually drink the water and then you can reuse it for months at a time. And it's, you know, it costs almost nothing. So filters. The first one is a very traditional pump filter. MSR MiniWorks, that's a really popular version. There's also the Katadyn filter. It's pretty much the same concept. This one is 14.6 ounces, so again, almost a pound. So you have your filter and your two Nalgene bottles. That's 2 pounds for just your water, plus your water. So that's almost $90, and it takes about a minute to filter a liter of water, which is pretty good. So it's not like it's the most inefficient thing ever, but it's expensive to buy one, and it weighs a lot. The Sawyer Mini is what I use. It actually, there's some options. I have directions on my site where you can make it inline. So I have the tubing for my bladder, so I have the bladder in my backpack, and I have a tube coming out, and I just cut the tube, and you can squeeze it onto both ends of your tubing, and as you're drinking your water that you just get from a stream, it's filtering. So
so it's automatically filtering your water as you drink it. It's $25, so you can get two and save money, so you can have a backup at home if you wanted to, or give it to a friend for less money than a traditional pump filter. So $25, 2 ounces, it's, you know, it weighs nothing. And the last option is Aquamira, which is a chemical droplet. I just don't tend to like chemical tastes in my water. You can taste it. And the other thing is that it does take 30 minutes for it to actually work. So, you know, if it's really hot out and you're thirsty, you do have to wait. But it's an option that a lot of people do like. It's convenient. If you go to, like, Walmart has them, and, you know, there's some stores along the trail, and if you're through hiking, that you can get more of those. You have a question?
Sorry.
Yeah, of course.
Do the filters have parts that need to replace? Do they have a lifespan?
So the Sawyer Mini does have, I don't know about the traditional pump filter, I believe you can replace parts in it. The Sawyer Mini, I don't remember the exact number, but it was like 100,000 gallons of water, something ridiculous. The only issue with the Sawyer Mini is if you use it in the winter and it freezes, then you have to replace it because it just, it'll break. So that's the only issue with it. It has a backwash system, so it's kind of like a syringe, and you put it in and you pump the water the opposite way that it's typically pumping, and it just gets any gunk, anything that's stuck in there. When I hiked the John Muir Trail, it was 15 days, and I never had to do that. So, you know, unless you're going on a through hike where you're spending 4 to 6 months, you won't need to do that during a trip.
So you'll know when it'll stop flowing. I guess the question is,
yeah, how do you know?
And then
yeah.
How it'll affect if you don't even know.
You won't, yeah, the flow will be a lot slower, so that's how you'll know. It's a pretty good flow rate. What I like to do is use it with a platypus bladder inline, so it's filtering as you drink. And the, I don't have it with me, but the platypus mouthpiece, it's kind of hard to suck the water through that and the filter. So I actually sometimes use the Camelback mouthpiece on the platypus, just the tubing connected to the platypus bladder. So it's just a system that works really well for me. And I like the way that the there's kind of an on-off switch on that system. So I kind of get the best of both worlds. But yeah, the flow will be a lot slower when it's not filtering. It won't just refuse to filter because the water physically has to go through the filter in order for you to drink it. So there's that. One thing I will say, I talked about repackaging. If you're repackaging your Aquamira, you want to make sure that the size of the hole of the container you're repackaging is the same size as the bottles, because you're not going to get the same droplets and it won't be effective. All right, so I'm going to talk a little bit more about multi-purpose items. So the joke is to really go ultralight. Everything must be multi-purpose. Like, for instance, my trowel is my spoon. Not really. So I don't go crazy far, but pretty much every item I bring with me has multiple purposes. You know those buff bandanas, it's like a tube. You can use that, you know, for gals or guys with longer hair. You can tie your hair back. You can use it to keep the sweat off your forehead. You can use it to filter your water if you're kind of more in an emergency situation where something fails or whatever it is. If you're hiking and you're hiking in a desert and it's sandy and the wind's blowing up all the sand, you can protect your face. If there is a forest fire that's happening and there's smoke, which I've been in before, and there's smoke where you're hiking, which can happen when it's miles and miles away, you can use that to cover your face as well. So just one item has a lot of uses. Your sleeping pad, like I showed you, you can have it in your backpack for a back pad. If you're using a foam sleeping pad, you can use it during the day just to sit on, obviously at night. The foam ones you can also use as first aid if you sprain your brink or break your leg, something like that. Obviously, you need to be carried out, but you can start making a split for yourself. I really do recommend taking a first aid, wilderness first aid class, and you'll get to know how to use all the items you bring with you and know what kind of first aid items you'll need in order to have
a good kit for helping yourself if you run into some trouble. Your hiking poles, I use those for river crossings, just for extra support, knowing if there's loose rocks, if it's icy, kind of seeing how icy it is. I use it to either hold up a tarp or a tent that can have a trekking pole holding one up. And then the nice thing is I do have a pair of trekking poles that has a strap, and you can remove the strap, and there's a hole, and I actually went to Home Depot and I got a piece of galvanized metal. It was just, I don't know what it's actually called, but I got a piece, and you can actually screw it in. I cut it, and you screw it in, and you can actually have your own, you know, do-it-yourself monopod, so you can have that, or you can use something like this, which is the GorillaPod. It's really lightweight, and, you don't have to not carry anything exciting and fun, so you can find different ways to carry things that really focus on the goal of your hike. So if you like photography or videography, if you want to capture moments on your hike, you still can. So that's always fun. Ziploc, if you're going to bring extras of anything, just bring one or two extra Ziplocs. You can repackage your items. If you have your cell phone or camera or something like a battery pack, just put it in a Ziploc. I tend to use these cubic fiber bags for my first aid items, but instead of carrying one of those like bulky box first aid kits that you can just buy at a store, just toss whatever you need in a Ziploc bag. It's waterproof, it's super light, and it's almost free. The other thing you can do is freezer bag cooking. There's tons of books on the subject. And what you do is you take a freezer bag, can't be a regular Ziploc, and you have your dehydrated food, and you just boil water and you put it right in your Ziploc, and just use a little koozie, and that's how you're eating your food. You eat out of a bag. So it's not, you know, gourmet at home where you have a nice plate and dishes and stuff, but you're only carrying just your cook pot and your stove. I can quickly go over your stove stuff too. You know, you can use it for first aid, so if you have a big gash on your leg, you can fill it with water and you poke a hole in it and you're able to direct the water onto the wound and clean it much better than just wiping it around with your dirty hands. Foot protection, this is an interesting one. If you're hiking in kind of torrential rain, you can actually have your sock on and you put a plastic bag, a Ziploc, something like that, in your shoe, and it's going to protect your feet from getting soaked. Same thing with, you know, blisters. So that's always fun. I typically don't do that, but it's an option. So, skills and practice. This is when I took the Wilderness First Aid course. So, I recommend taking these courses because when you're taking less gear, you're doing it with a purpose. And you'll also need to know how to appropriately do a variety of skills using the gear that you have. So the most important gear that you'll need is your brain and just thinking things through. You know, I'm sure you've all heard stories of people that they just bring a water bottle and they get lost and, you know, something horrible happens and they get rescued. Or someone that starts hiking off trails, use the bathroom, and you know, instead of just turning around or having a bright bandana on their backpack, what I like to do is have my backpack on the side of the trail, have a bright bandana or something. I use the bathroom, I come back, I can see where my gear is. So just being conscious of where you are and what you're doing and just using your head is just the best item that you can bring. So you don't need tons of all this fancy gear. You know, just the basics, it's just walking. A lot of people make it seem like it's this huge thing that, you know, only the best can do, and you'll see online everyone tries to make themselves seem like a hiking expert, but it's something that everyone can do at different levels. So these courses are just so important because they'll teach you the skills that you need. So Wilderness First Aid, I've been certified in regular first aid since I was about 14, I think. I get it recertified all the time. But the wilderness aspect is really important because when you're taking normal first aid, you're kind of helping someone out or helping yourself out for 10, 15, 20 minutes until an ambulance comes. But with wilderness first aid, you could be on your own for hours. And the biggest thing they push is just knowing what to do and thinking things through before you do it. So just using your brain. AMC has a ton of great leadership courses. They have a winter hiking program. They have overnight courses. So there's a lot of different skills you can use that they'll teach you. Map and Compass. Some people, they'll bring their phone and they'll have an app, and it's a great resource and it can be fun to use, but I always bring, this weighs almost nothing, and same thing with this. You can get waterproof maps. It's just, I don't know why you wouldn't bring this. There's no person that is carrying stuff that's so light that they can't bother to bring basic map and compass. And the thing is, you'll want to know how to use a map and compass. So, you know, you need to know how to read contour lines and make sure that you properly identify where north is. So there's different skills that if you don't know, there's tons of programs out there. You can just Google them. But AMC has a lot of courses on map and compass, as well as a lot of different other programs. And Leave No Trace is great too. So if you need to learn how to dig a cat hole, or you know, if you don't know how far away from water you need to camp and use the bathroom, then just go on lnt.org, I believe it is, and they have tons of information online. Okay, so I found this the other day and I thought it was funny. So sorry, guys. So backpacking is the only sport which men brag about how small their stuff is. So it's just one of those things that you'll get on the trail, and this goes for men and women, that there's some people that are exceptionally proud of how much stuff they're carrying. When I threw hike the John Muir Trail, it was, I remember someone telling me, oh yeah, they were just camping overnight. I have a 3-course meal and 2 bottles of wine. And, you know, I was very lightweight when I was hiking that. And I said, all right, well, if you can keep up with me, you can share. And, you know, I just had to tease him that he had all this stuff, and he just had different goals. And a lot of people, you know, they'll ask you, oh, you know, do you have enough gear, and, you know, all this stuff. And you can get a lot of looks and a lot of questions, and it's really great to use the skills that you're learning to educate others. So it's one of those kind of hike your own hike, and when you're going through the process, if you have friends or family that have already transitioned and they have all the gear that they need to be ultralight, and you're going from 40 pounds to 30 pounds, it's all right too. So everything works differently for other people. So I'm going to quickly go through a few items I didn't talk about, and then if you have any questions, then you can let me know as well. So stove stuff, there's a few options here. This is an alcohol stove. It's just a can. And this one I bought, you can make it, but there's companies that's really cheap, and you can buy them pre-made, and they're perfect, and you don't burn yourself or cut yourself doing it. So you just use alcohol in here. This is just a bottle that is a whole kit that came together, which is great. So you just use it in here, you put them in here, and you're able to just light this. And then this is actually a can. Foster's or I believe it's Heineken also has the right shape can. So it's just a can that's wide enough, and this is your cook pot. I literally only use this for boiling water. So I'll either go on a trip that I only need to boil water, or I don't use a stove at all, and I eat food that doesn't require a stove. So this is a great system where, you know, it's very simple. Then you have the more traditional stove. You know, you have, this is MSR pocket rocket, that's what they call it. MSR pocket rocket. So if you're still using the fuel canisters, you know, these are kind of heavy. They have an even smaller version of this that if you're going just overnight or, you know, maybe 2 or 3 days, you can get the smaller version and it will last you plenty, especially if you're just boiling water. So you use this paired with this, and it's a pretty foolproof system that, you know, if you want something easy, it'll boil your water very fast, this is a great option. This is just a traditional pot that, you know, you go like that, and that's your whole system. Then the last one, I didn't bring the little stove piece for this, but these are Esbit. They're solid fuel cubes, and it's just another version. They do make your cook pot smell but that's pretty much it. These are really great, they're easy to use, and you can use, you know, a Cubanite, so you really know how many you need for a trip. So that's cooking. But over first aid, one thing I do like to always bring is emergency bivy. It's Survive Outdoors Longer, that's the company that makes them. And it's just great day hiking, backpacking. Backpacking, I typically don't bring this. Day hiking or a really long hike that I'm planning on coming home, and I'm not planning on staying on the trail. Obviously, I've never used this because I don't think I could get it back in this package just like this. But this is something that I just like to have in case, you know, there's ever an emergency and I need to camp out overnight. It's not comfortable. I'm not going to be, you know, exceptionally warm and cozy, but it'll help me survive outdoors longer. So that's just one thing that I like to bring. Winter, I tend to bring a sleeping bag because that isn't going to do a whole lot if you get stuck overnight in the winter. I do like to always make sure, no matter what, I bring a traditional headlamp. This is a pencil headlamp. It works very well. I don't bring, there's this tiny little pencil, it's in pencil E-Lite, and I do have one that I use as a backup. I just have in there, make sure you bring extra batteries, but I don't skimp out on my headlamp because, you know, I do a lot of night hiking, I do a lot of sunrise, sunset hikes, and if you're doing a regular day hike and you get stuck longer than you think you're going to, you get injured, you want to make sure that you have a headlamp, so just don't skimp out on something like that. It's really easy just to pack bars and snacks and stuff like that. Sandwiches, you know, it's things are really simple. There's tons of trail cookbooks where you can make pretty gourmet foods with boiled water. For backpacking, I tried using a solar panel for, you know, my electronics and all that stuff. And so I was going to be hiking out west. And I tried it out here, and every single hike was too cloudy or rained or something because it's New England. So I just returned the solar panel. It was just kind of a roll-up one, and thought it would be good, but it wasn't reliable. So this is a little heavier. It's the Rack Power. I think it's 8 ounces, and it can charge your phone multiple times, and you know your camera. And if you are through hiking or doing some kind of a longer backpacking trip, you can recharge it in town or at a resupply, but it gives your phone a couple more charges. I also will bring just extra batteries for my phone or for my camera, just so I don't have to charge it, and those are pretty light. So there's different options depending on how long your trip is, what you plan on doing. The last thing, and then I'll take questions, is since I switched to the low trail runners, you can get a lot of dirt and debris in your shoes. These are made specifically for kind of long-distance ultra trail runners, marathon runners. They actually just have a piece of Velcro and this clip, and they go like this. And it keeps all the dirt and debris, because your ankle goes in here, and it keeps it all out of your shoe. When I was on the Drown Your Trail one morning, I was just too lazy to put them on, and 20 minutes later I had to because I had so much, you know, rocks and sand in my shoes. And these shoes actually have a Velcro piece specifically for the gaiters. It's not the same company that makes them. And these, if you are like me, I have outer space ones, and they have like sushi ones and fish ones and, I don't know, pickles, I'm sure, and weird stuff. So you can get some fun designs. So overall, just slowly transition in order to get your pack weight where you want it to be. Your goal should be not to have the lightest backpack, but to be able to hike farther, hike faster if you want to, hike without pain. You know, be able to hike when you're older as well. A lot of people in their, you know, 60s, 70s, 80s are still hiking, and it's because they're not carrying 60 pounds on their back. So, hope that has helped. Any questions that you have, let me know. And I also have some cards in the back, so I have my phone on there as well, so you can ask. Any questions? Yes, go ahead.
You go first.
Okay, go ahead.
Yes.
So I don't have a really light sleeping bag, so the only time I carry my sleeping bag is about carrying my big 5 liter piece of a pack, which I prefer not to carry.
Yep.
I usually use like a 35, 40 liter, even when I'm overnighting. Bear canister I use is like one of those small 10 liter ones, like the individual size.
Yeah.
And believe it or not, I have found a way to pack 9,000 calories worth of food into that little
bag. Yep.
You know, asking a lot of questions, getting suggestions from people and stuff, and finally figuring out how to get the 5,000-6,000 calories into 9,000 into that little tiny
thing,
so I don't have to carry the big piece of the canister the sleeping system, I have the synthetic bag, it's heavy, and it doesn't pack very well at all. I do have a bivy, which is actually quite a bit larger than that one.
Yep.
It's got the mirror inside.
Okay.
So it reflects the.
Your feet, yep.
You do have to have the hood on, though.
Okay.
Because otherwise, it all the air spins right out.
Is it loud? Because of the material?
I don't move too much.
Okay.
And typically, what I've been doing is I usually bring 3 layers.
Yep.
And a winter hat, like, everywhere.
Yep.
And I just put all those clothes on and get into that bivy and then. Make sure to tie the hood.
Yeah.
Don't even bring a sleeping bag.
Okay.
So I don't, and it's worked fine as long as I've been wearing all that stuff.
Yeah.
The thing is, like, let's say I go to Colorado, which I will be next week.
Oh, nice. Enjoy.
So where I'm camping out will be, anywhere from 8,000, well, 8,000 is the very lowest, to like 11 or 12,000 feet. Where I'm camping, like about where tree line is, and even in late July, the warmest time of year, it could still get a little cold there.
Yep.
And I never kept track of what the temperature actually was when I was sleeping overnight in the lights. Because I was like, okay, well, I'm warm. So I don't know where the question would come at this point. It's just,
are you trying to change your sleep system or?
Yeah, because I'm thinking that I use the bivy and just wear a lot of clothes to kind of offset the fact that I have a 5-pound backpacking tent.
Yeah.
To try to lose weight somewhere if I'm not losing it somewhere else. But I don't know if that's considered a really acceptable way to go about dropping weight, like to just ditch the sleeping bag and use your bivy instead.
If it works for you, it works for you. The other option you could do is if you're worried about maybe some days that you'll be a little cold, is to get, instead of spending $300 on a new sleeping bag, is to get, so you can use your sub liner, and that's going to add, about 10 degrees.
Oh, yeah.
And also, there's some other tricks I think you can, the Nalgene trick, you have to have Nalgene, that's the problem. If you fill it with boiling water, you have that. At your feet, but you have to have an Nalgene, which is a little bit of weight. But you're typically, if you're used to that setup in the summer, spring around here, it's not going to be exceptionally colder if you camp right. So you'll see a beautiful lake. Don't camp there because it's going to be cold.
Okay.
So enjoy the view. Maybe camp close enough that for breakfast you can enjoy the sunrise or whatever it is. But if you're camping, below tree line, in the woods, even if you're at timberline, then you can still be in the woods and get the protection and the warmth from there. The other thing is don't camp in a meadow because you'll get a lot of water condensation and, it'll be cold just because of the air.
Yeah,
you're very exposed. So, if you use the setup that you have and just be smart about where you camp, that will help a lot.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but, eventually I think for you, just scour eBay, Black Friday, see if you can score a decent. Enlighten Equipment did lower the prices. I don't know if maybe they're just manufacturing more here, but they're USA made stuff. And I know, for some reason their stuff isn't as expensive as it was.
Oh.
I think Enlighten Equipment, that's
Enlighten.
The quilt that I have.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
And they have a bunch of different kinds of sleeping bags. They're not terribly expensive, so that's an option. They have different options within, the realm of what they have.
Yeah.
And you can get a custom bag, but they take a while to ship, or they have one
that are already made, that, you know, they make the most popular ones a lot.
Yeah.
So that's an option down the road, and then eventually you can switch out your backpack once you have the rest of your gear. So, yeah, it's just something, you know, you could rent a sleeping bag that's down for this trip particularly, but yeah, if the system works for you, it works for you for now.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
So maybe to your comment, my brother does survivalist camping, and he's talked, I don't remember the details, but he talked about using like leaves and sticks and branches, so almost like you would have a little shelter to add a little bit of insulation.
Oh, more stationary air.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even just like padding the ground with all these
trees.
Oh, yeah.
Warmer that way. I don't know the area you've been going in, but I don't know.
Yeah. Mountains.
Well, the other, something related to that, that I just thought about, people in the winter, what they do is they'll bring two sleeping pads. So they'll have a foam pad, a really thin foam pad, and then they'll have their inflatable on top, and it's really not much more weight, and it's really thin, so it rolls up pretty small. You just need to find a way of kind of, people mostly have it attached to the outside of their backpack. Yeah. So you have that, but you can have a really thin version of it. Goss Creeker has a thin, light pad, that's what they call it, and it's a long kind of foam material, and you use that, and then you're inflatable, and that creates that same kind of layering system underneath you, so you're higher up off the ground.
Yeah.
You had a separate question?
Yeah. So, someone who's only done, like, and short couple hour hikes.
Mm-hmm.
How do you make that initial leap into your first extended day hike, your first overnight hike? How do you make that fear leap of, okay, I don't know what I'm doing, but I'm going to try this?
Alright, so the first thing that I do, that and it really does help, it sounds kind of silly, is literally get all of the gear that you'll be using and camp in your backyard. That way, you know, especially if you, I do a lot of solo hiking, when I did the John Muir Trail, I was by myself, you know, I do a good amount with friends and stuff, but, yeah, it is scary no matter what, when you first start, especially going solo, every little noise is a bear or something is going to eat you, and it never is, it's always a mouse in your tent, which I've had before. So what you'll want to do is just have all of your gear and camp out and make sure that you're comfortable and you can actually keep track, like, you know, look up the weather on your phone or, you know, use a thermometer and see what the weather is. And that way you're mentally, you know, okay, with the gear that I have in these weather conditions, I'm comfortable. So that's out of your mind when you're actually camping. And then I have some certain systems that work for me. Like when I camp at night, I always put my headlamp in my right shoe, and I have it, you know, kind of close to my head, which I don't know why, because my shoes probably smell, but I smell, so I don't smell it. So, it's just systems that I know if there's kind of a creepy noise, I'm not jigging around everywhere with my headlamp, I know exactly where it is. So, there's things that you're going to be afraid of absolutely nothing, and it's okay, because everyone is afraid of something, and it takes a while, and sometimes it doesn't go away. But systems that you start to acquire are really helpful. So, yeah, just camp in your backyard, and then the next one, you know, maybe camp with friends on an actual trip, and if you don't have their gear and they do, then, you know, I would go with someone that has a little bit more experience, and they can kind of share knowledge and gear if you need it. And you can even camp so you're not real close to them. And it feels like you're, you know, you're on your own. And then do a shorter backpacking trip, maybe overnight, that, let's say you just, I don't know, completely forgot something so important that you needed, that the mileage isn't too much, that you can still hike out and get back to your car and go home if you need to. And just build up from there. But yeah, no matter what, you're going to freak yourself out from absolutely nothing, and it happens to everyone. So, yeah, when I was on the JMT, the first night I was super freaked out because there was all these people that, long story, but like for various reasons, they like were afraid to put all their food away, and that's where there's a lot of bears that are a little bit more aggressive. So because there's all these people, that freaked me out more. So there's always going to be something that you'll scare yourself for a reason or for no reason at all. Any other questions? Okay, so I have some cards. It's just my business cards. In the back, I have Trail to Summit. So it's just trailtosummit.com. That's my site. I mind my cell phone and my email. If you have questions, then seriously feel free to let me know. Happy to help. If you have questions about, you know, the type of gear and all that stuff, let me know too. And then if you kind of try some of the stuff out and go on some adventures, and if it works out or it doesn't work out, then let me know. I'd always love to hear. Thank you guys so much.